5 years ago, he's working on a newspaper in Iran. Government shuts it down, censors. So he leaves, comes to Canada, starts a political blog about Iran called Hoder.com, H-O-D-E-R, Hoder.com. It's one of the first of its kind. Hoder, because Hossein Derakhshan is the name, Hoder, or as some people call him, the godfather of Iranian blogging, although he's a little young and slim to be the godfather. Nice to see you, man.
I see you, man.
How are you?
Thanks.
Look at that shirt. You heart Tehran.
Yeah, it's like an anti-war statement.
There you go. You know, you know how it is in the West, right? Leaders speak, and oftentimes they don't represent what a lot of people actually believe. When Ahmadinejad says what he says, how in step with the people of Iran is he when he talks like this?
I mean, a lot of people from the uneducated, less urban areas are really with him, and that's the people who elected him. Mm-hmm. But the thing about him is that there are lots of things that he's not really setting the policies for. For example, Israel thing, the nuclear thing, they're not policies that probably he is only advocating. Mm-hmm. In terms of the nuclear program, for example, he is just a puppet.
They have a supreme leader, right?
There's a supreme leader that everyone totally ignores now, who has the total control on the army, on the media, and a lot of on foreign policy and a lot of other issues. But I don't know why the media tries to forget that. Ahmadinejad doesn't have control in the army, so the things that he says about Israel are not really threatening, because he can't even move one soldier from this city to another city.
But you got to imagine that the supreme leader would look at him and say, listen, this whole wiping Israel off the map thing, tone it down a bit. Because you got to think that if they didn't agree with him, they would try to shut him down.
It's true, but it's really difficult for them to, you know, to work around these fighting, internal fights, because he represents a very, very rigid, strong, enthusiastic group of people who never had any political power. Mm-hmm. They fought the war. They claim that they were really responsible for the winning, if you can call it, because Iran didn't lose any land or anything.
Right.
But they never had any kind of power in the political scene. They had a lot of economic opportunities and some other stuff, but they were never really involved in policy making. So this is the time that they want to say that we can run this country, and you have to really take us seriously. But now you're seeing that in many issues in terms of economy and a lot of that, they're really blowing it.
Well, and the only thing that ever gets real play is the whole Israel and the nukes thing. You know, you know, when he talks the big game about nuclear technology, when he says the more you pressure us, the bigger we'll build, we're 10 times more capable, do the people at home just go, cool it, you're going to get us smoked here, or you're going to turn us into Baghdad, or do they like what he's saying?
Yeah, some time ago, I think people were really worried about some sort of military attack against Iran or even sanctions, but now the situation in the world is so, in such a way that I think a few people in Iran would think that they would, that this kind of talk would have any serious consequences. He is bluffing. Iran is bluffing in this game. They're playing whatever they have in this game. They have so many cards, and the U.S. has no cards, basically. Mm-hmm. Iran has Iraq, Afghanistan, the oil, you know, Lebanon, Hamas, and Iran has so many cards, and the U.S. don't have anything. So they're pretty confident that even the sanctions could not work against Iran, because China and Russia are against it.
You mentioned China, and there's actually some similarities between the Chinese government and the Iranian government in the restriction of information to people. Yeah. Your blog has tens of thousands of people a day who are checking this out. Now, your blog can't be read by people in Iran, right?
But unless they use proxies and some other.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Which is another story. We should do that one day on tours. But
yeah,
you got enough to do.
Yeah,
we'll take care of that. You handle that. But the idea that, like, you hear so much about how young Iran is. How many youth are there? Are they politically active?
Unfortunately, not anymore. Because the daily life is becoming so frustrating, and at the same time, the expectation about their social freedom is so low that the government can easily satisfy them with a little bit of pop music, with a little bit of,
is the pop music there as crap as the pop music here, or is it actually good?
The content, I think, could be more valuable, I guess you could say.
But, in terms of blogs, though, is there really?
No, of course there's not.
Does the, because you can have Britney. We'll give you Britney, give us somebody else. It's a fair trade.
Yeah.
Straight up, okay. the blogging community, talk about the impact. Is it having an impact there? Because I know that here blogging is kind of like a bunch of people telling me about what they did today. But I can imagine in Iran, there's so much more power one can have with a blog.
Yeah, blogs are really, I think, playing a good role in Iran now in terms of, it's more of a cultural kind of influence than a political one.
Okay.
Because this is the first time that a massive I mean, a big number of people are exercising being tolerant to get people's comments, being self-expressive. And these are the new values that has emerged among the new generation. If blogging was about to happen for our parents' generation, it wouldn't have caught on because they were not ready to express themselves and to tolerate comments and different opinions.
But you don't write about, I mean, you do cultural stuff, but you talk about politics, man. You really...
Recently, because there's no choice, because you're constantly being bombarded by all these news.
Well, you were detained as well. You don't make your home in Iran anymore. You're not so big with the government. Can you go back there again?
I'd love to go back, but I don't think I can, especially after the trip to Israel that I did a few months ago.
You were very public about it, which most Iranians don't do.
Yeah, I blogged about it. I posted videos and pictures and everything, and those were the first pictures that any Iranian has seen about Israel without the government, out of the government propaganda.
But before you went to Israel, you were detained.
Yeah, I was detained at the airport when I tried to leave Iran last summer because of my writing on the blog, and I was stopped by the intelligence ministry, and I was interrogated. It was quite friendly and professionally, but it was still, you know, a big issue. They expected me not to write something against Iranian rules, although I was living outside Iran. Certain issues, number of issues that I was discussing, including the Supreme Leader, you can't criticize him because he's the symbolic presence of the whole regime, about the nuclear program, about Iran-Israel, about the filtering. If there is a blog that is showing people how to bypass these filters, it would be filtered itself.
But aren't you on, like, you're not against Iran having a nuclear program, right?
No, I'm saying that they have a nuclear weapon. They have to have nuclear weapons. There's no choice. The thing now is that the interest of Iran is overlapped. Overlaps the interest of the Islamic Republic. They are very, very similar now, and I think they have no choice. If you have energy, if you want to be independent in that region, there's no choice other than having nuclear weapons as deterrent.
If you want to make sure you don't get attacked, I guess you need a nuclear bomb as well, right?
Yeah, and so that's why I'm saying I've sort of changed my opinion about this. I used to say that Iran doesn't need nuclear energy because it's too environmentally damaging and it just doesn't make sense for Iran with that much amount of oil. But then I realized that, you know, the U.S. wants to topple this regime. This is a semi-democratic thing that is very much different with North Korea and with Saudi Arabia that the U.S. protecting is, you know, insanely. So I think Iran is in a situation that has to protect itself. And this is actually one of the arguments that I say, and a lot of people disagree with it, that even if Iran had the nuclear weapons, it would open up the internal issues, internal policy that would ease a lot of them because many of these limitations are only because of the threat.
That's what you're saying. You know, we're running out of time, but you got to come back. I want to carry on this discussion. It's nice to see you, man.
You too.
Hossein, thank you very much for coming on. There you go.